Greetings and welcome to Astronomy and Physical Science at HAC. The purpose of this video is an explanation of the solar observing project that you will be doing as a part of this class. And what this project is a chance to actually have you get out and make some observations of the sun, a very easy astronomical object to be able to see. But we're going to actually be observing that and seeing what the length of the shadow is cast by an object and how that changes over the course of the semester. You will note that this is worth a lot of points towards your final grade. Part of that is getting the observations, and part of it is actually an analysis of them that we will do later in the semester. Now, there is some information here. I'm not going to go and reread through all of the information here. You can go through that. But what I really want you to look at, and some of the things that I want to emphasize, is that this is a project to really get you to see what is going on out in the sky. Things that you've seen every day, but maybe never really put together. You will make measurements just as an astronomer would have done thousands of years ago. We don't need anything complicated or detailed, a very simple project, but you can really get a deep understanding of some of the motions that occur by completing this successfully. You do need to begin early in the semester, so you do not want to wait until the end of the semester to try to get your observations. I will give you the numbers later, but I generally look for 10 observations spread over the semester that I ask you to get. It's about one every week to 10 days. So that's not too bad, and it works very well around people who have busy schedules, including work schedules and school schedules and home life as well. It makes it possible to do that. I will give you a data table to be able to use, and then finally at the end we will use you will write a report and an analysis of what you found out in this project. Now, what we're going to look at the motions of the sun, we're going to see that the sun's position changes because the Earth is tilted. So the Earth is tilted at a 23.5 degree, and that means that the sun's declination will change from plus 23.5 degrees in the summer to minus 23.5 degrees in the winter. Were the Earth not tilted, then there would be no change in that, and there would be no seasons. Now, what we want to look at, what we're going to be doing here, is altitude measurements. We're going to measure how high the sun is in the sky at noon. Now, what do we mean by noon? Not noon by the clock, but noon is when the sun is highest in the sky. And that occurs for Harrisburg, where we're based, at about 12:15 Eastern Standard Time and 1:15 Eastern Daylight Time. So that means, in general, from March to October, you would observe at 1:15 p.m. And from November through February, you would observe at 12:15 p.m. The exact dates will, of course, depend on when daylight savings time starts and ends each year. So I will provide that extra information, but pretty much this will work anywhere if you are in the south central Pennsylvania area. If you're a lot further east or a lot further west, and we're talking hundreds of miles, then you can look at getting an updated time from your instructor. The observing time might be a little bit. But what you're going to do is to measure the length of the shadow an object casts. So a very good hard solid surface is suggested. You don't want to measure on a grassy surface or a very soft dirt surface where it's difficult to get accurate measurements. The type of object that you want to use is would be something that you can measure easily. A box or a can work very well. But what I do say is that you want something that is uniform in shape. What I mean is that a water bottle is not a good thing to use because it tapers at the top. So something that comes to a point at the top is not a very good object to measure, because the shadow will be cast, and it will cast a shadow, but the shadow is being cast from this point here, and you're measuring the shadow from here, you're going to not measure the true length of the shadow. In this case, you're going to be underestimating the length of the shadow because the object tapers. And an object like a water bottle, you might be off by a centimeter or two, depending on how pointed it gets towards the top. So a water bottle is not a good thing. A box or a can, something that is the same diameter at the top and the bottom, is very good to use. You also do not want to include the object in your measurement. So when you're measuring that object, you want to measure from the end here, as I've shown. You do not want to include the rest of the objects. You don't want to measure this portion as well. You don't want to do that because that will then, in that case, you would be overestimating the length of your shadow. Either one of those will cause a systematic error in your observations that would need to be corrected. So I kind of show it in the little image here. Here's a pole standing up. The pole casts a shadow that we measure down here. And what you're going to measure is how high this pole is. And you're going to measure how long the shadow is. And really, for right now, that's all you need to be able to do. I include some of the information needed for the calculations here. So you're going to take some of these and use this to do the calculations. This is done later. So you do not have to worry about that right now. We will come back to that later in the semester, and there will be additional information and additional videos explaining how to do this. As I said, I'm looking for 10 observations scattered over the course of the semester. So not just the first 10 clear days in the semester and you're done. You want it spread over at least a couple of months to be able to get the best values possible. We're also going to do some graphing. And again, this comes later. We will do this later on in the semester, and I will provide some specific information as to how to go about completing the graphs successfully. Now, I also have some other information here, just some general comments and some expectations that you want to look at. These sample questions, you'll want to come back to these because these are required to be answered as part of your final write-up. So this is part, not all, of the analysis that you'll be doing for the project. So you're going to need to answer those in your write-up as you do those. I give you some general comments here, tell you a little bit about your observations, etc., especially record everything in your data table. Very easy to try to just record things and keep track, and I'll remember that number, but you will not. So it's very hard to keep track of that. So you can read some general expectations here, a few other expectations about the report, and I'll give you some more detail on that shortly. But I am looking for 10 observations over the semester, and those are 10 successful observations. I'm looking for the analysis, which is partially answering these sample questions and partially an analysis of your observations. And I will provide you some data to use to look at as well. So you'll get additional data that are provided so that you can compare what you did get to what you should have gotten. Now, this is the write-up information. So what do we have? What are you going to be doing for the write-up here? Well, this tells you exactly what you need for each section and what each part will be. You're going to need a title page worth 5 points, and that title page must contain this specific information. The introduction is worth 10 points. Your purpose and your methods describe what you're doing and why you're doing it. The data are worth 30 points. Now, 15 of these I give during the semester. At 3 points during the semester, I collect the data. So 3 times during the semester, I will collect your data, ask you to turn in your observation sheet to make sure that you're staying on track with this. And I make certain deductions. First of all, I give you 1.5 points per observation, up to 10 maximum. I do limit that if you're taking this in a shortened class, if you're taking this in a late start or a 12-week summer class, a few less observations are needed. And 6-week summer classes, which are extremely tense, need only a few, even fewer observations. I do deduct a few points if your observations do not spread over at least 2 full months. So if you start making observations on August 31st, then you want to be making observations into the very beginning of November. You want 2 complete months included in your observations. And again, that is lowered down that you want 6 weeks for the 12-week summer class and 4 weeks for the 6-week class. So they're a little bit spread, a little bit cut down if you're taking this in a shorter class. You will lose credit completely if you use only my data. I will provide some data for you. If you only use that as part of as for your analysis, you will not get any of the points for the data. So you will lose all of that. However, you can still continue and get the rest of the information. There are graphs that we're going to do. And again, I will provide explanation as to exactly what those are. But there's going to be two graphs. You have to use graph paper. I provide some. You can also get free graph paper online. They have to be labeled and scaled, and they have to show your data and mine on the same graphs. These can be done by hand or by computer. Either one is perfectly acceptable as long as all of the information is included there, as long as everything is done properly. And the graphs are worth 30 points. The analysis is worth 50 points, so a big section here. And I do note 4 to 5 paragraphs minimum. You're not going to be able to get everything done without that. I give you some sample questions here, some things to talk about in terms of your graphs. How did they compare together? And then answer those original sample questions that I showed you just a little bit ago. You're going to want to go back, and those are going to be one section of your analysis as well. So about half of your analysis points, half of the analysis points come right here. Just those questions are about 25 points worth, and that is a big chunk of your analysis. Finally, at the end, you're going to want conclusions. So summarize your findings. What might you do differently again, and what questions are you left with? Make sure you answer all of these. So these all need to be included. I have no questions is not acceptable, for example. You've got to come up with something. References in terms of your analysis and some of the questions, you might have had to use some external sources. And I require that you use a minimum of 3 of those and that you cite those appropriately in the write-up where you use them, and then give a sources a works cited page at the end as to what you used. That can include information. It can also include images if you used images as part of your explanations. Finally, the writing format is worth 10 points. I do require a header for each section, so you want to have introduction labeled as introduction, data, and then your data tables, graphs and the graphs and the analysis and so on. And you want to have each of those sections headered and given all the information that you need to include right in there. And I also say that for my online classes, it must be completed in a single file, and you have to do it in order. So you have to go through everything from your title page down to your references in that order, and the graphs and the data must be included within that final write-up. So I want everything in one place, as it makes it so much easier to go through and grade. So if you submit it in multiple files, that's all, you can do it, but you will lose some of the credit for the writing format, which is 10 points worth. So you would lose some of the credit there. So that's just jumping ahead, looking at what I'm going to be grading it on, but it gives you a chance to think about that a little bit. The last thing I provide at the beginning is a data table. You can use this if you like, or you can make up your own data table. Some people want to do it in Excel or on their own device, and that's perfectly fine. But all you want to do here is record the date of your observation. So for right now, all you have to do is say, I observed on the 1st of September, and I observed that at 1:25 p.m. The sky was clear, and I measured the shadow length to be, let's say, 17 centimeters, and my object was 20 centimeters high. For right now, you don't need to worry about any of this. If you're good with math and you want to work on it, that's fine. But all you need to be doing is filling in these columns over the course of the semester. When we come to the last month of the semester, I will provide additional information as to how to calculate each of these last 4 columns. But for right now, all you need to be doing is collecting your data, and that's all that you'll do for the very first part of the course. So this video has been to explain a little bit on how the Solar Observations Project will work. There will be some additional information and videos provided as well over the course of the semester. So until next time, have a great day, everyone, and I will see you in class.